Divine True Spirit Discussions. Discussions with people who have lived on earth and who have now passed into the spirit world. Jesus and Mary present Mandy, an American Christian woman who shares her experience discovering divine truth. The session was recorded on the 14th of January 2016 in Wilkesdale, Queensland, Australia.
So Mary and I have just been talking to a number of spirits who wanted to share with you, particularly share with those people who are coming along to the assistance groups, their life after they've passed and their life on earth as well, because they could see a lot of similarities between their own lives and your lives, particularly for those who are coming along to our group. So we're now up to our third spirit who wants to share with us, and her name's Mandy. We've just had two before her, Glenn and Sarah. And so this, so what we'll do now is discuss what Mandy wants to talk about with us about her life that she's had both on earth and after she's passed.
Hi there.
Howdy, Mandy.
So I've been brought to speak with you.
Yeah. And have you been present while Sarah? And,
yes.
Yep. So yeah. you know the general layout of what I'd like to be able to do with you.
Yeah, so yeah, so you'd like to hear a bit about my life on earth first.
I would love to.
Yeah. So I was a member of a church when I was on earth, and
do you mind me asking which church?
The Mormon church, actually.
Okay.
Yeah. Yep. And I considered myself quite a spiritual person.
Yep.
And really, I feel that's one of the main reasons I've been selected to speak with you today,
right?
Because I lived in a lot of feeling that I was serving others and that I was quite spiritual and quite evolved spiritually, really.
Yes.
And I lived in a lot of denial of my real feelings.
Of your real emotional state.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I had a husband and a family, and I lived to be an older woman on earth. Mm-hmm. I died of breast cancer.
Yeah.
And
which breast was it?
My left breast.
Left breast, yeah.
Yeah.
And how long ago was that?
We
could just ask our spirit friends, they might help with that.
Yes, yeah. That was about 50 years ago.
Right,
that I
so passed. You passed around 50 years ago.
Yeah.
So you lived from the late 1800s to 1950 or 60?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. Yes, and as I said, I was very involved with my church. I lived in the USA.
Yeah.
I was born around the turn of the century, so not, I wasn't in the 1800s.
Right. So you died in your 60s.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Had four children.
Yeah.
Husband. And I believe that I was living a good life.
Yep. You felt yourself to be connected to God, and you felt yourself to be religious and righteous and moral and
yes, all those things. And I espoused a lot of values.
Yeah.
Like service to others, community, love of one another, strong family values, respect of men.
So you talk the talk.
I talk the talk a lot. And I talk the talk so much that I even believed it myself.
Yes, I understand.
And that was what was really shocking for me when I passed over, because I was met by other members of my faith, people from my family line. I thought things were going to be going lovely. And
when you first passed, you were met by them?
Yes.
Yep.
Yep.
And many of them were bright by this stage, were they? Or were they, what condition were they?
Varying.
Varying conditions.
Yep. And so I wasn't very aware.
So the initial passing was relatively
calm.
And, and also you had quite a number of friends and companions or people who knew you to welcome you into your new life.
Yep.
So that would have felt reassuring initially.
It did. And I felt, I wasn't very self-aware, and so I wasn't really aware of the varied brightness or the differing conditions between people who came to see me.
Yep.
I was more interested in what people were telling me.
Yes.
And interested in continuing on in the kind of life that I felt was good and moral.
Yes.
And so I ended up with going with a group of spirits who sort of espouse, who I can now see were very similar to me.
Yes.
They espouse Christian values. It wasn't even particularly Mormon values.
Yeah.
I wouldn't say that I was like a devout Mormon or anything. Mm-hmm. What really drew me to any kind of spiritual endeavor was this feeling that I was being a better person.
Yeah.
That was very important to me, even though I didn't really understand that while I was on Earth, but I was really driven to feel like I was a good person.
Yes.
And so...
Even if that meant believing in a facade of your own making.
Definitely. Yeah. And I felt that the more actions I took and the more I conformed with a certain... So the more actions I took that seemed to be good,
mm-hmm.
and the more actions I took to conform with the group that told me that what I was doing was good.
Yep.
Then the better a person I was going to become.
Yes. Yep.
And I was actually hiding from a lot of things that had happened in my childhood that actually made me feel quite ashamed
mm-hmm.
of myself. And so I was, I was kind of driven towards what I called being a spiritual, good, holy kind of a woman.
Mm.
And
do you mind me asking about those things that caused you to feel ashamed?
Yeah, I was sexually abused.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
By my father.
Yeah.
And I actually wasn't born in the Mormon faith or anything.
No.
I ended up...
You ended up finding the faith.
Yeah.
And almost using the faith as a rescue for not having to address certain feelings.
I saw it as a way to become more worthy or more less shameful.
Less shameful.
I didn't think about that, but I understand that now.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I was really driven and I wanted to feel like I wanted to believe that there was a God who loved me and that took away all my sins. And I wanted to believe that.
Yeah.
Wanted to believe in you as a wonderful person who did that for me. And, I wanted to believe that the more good acts I did and the more of a sort of sunny disposition I displayed to other people, the further I was getting away from the shame of my childhood and what I believe made me an unlovable person.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, and the initial passing then was quite different to Sarah's, who we just spoke to.
Yeah, very different. Very different.
And quite different to Glenn's too. Glenn spent a lot of alone time when he first passed. And
yeah.
So you had a different passing where the people who knew you came to you. And
yep.
And that must have felt initially a bit reassuring.
yeah, it did.
Mm-hmm.
I sort of didn't understand it, but through the course of my illness,
mm-hmm.
before I passed, and then during the process of passing, a lot of old fears that I'd been suppressing for a long time began to be surface sort mm-hmm. of in me.
Mm-hmm.
I still didn't want to be aware of them.
Mm-hmm.
And when I was met by this group of people who sort of espoused these same values as me, I went with them because I really, really wanted to just join another group where I could feel like I was doing something good and get away from any feeling of shame or insecurity about myself.
And that group was a mixture of men and women?
Yeah.
Yep.
And so what I found was that they took me away to a place that it wasn't, well, when I listened to the experience of Sarah
mm-hmm.
and even of Glenn, mm-hmm. it wasn't that dark.
No.
I was sort of in this kind of, I'm going to call it bland.
Mm-hmm.
It seemed sort of a...
Grey.
If an environment can be bland, it was bland. It mm-hmm. was sort of colourless and... Mm-hmm. It wasn't terribly dark or cold or anything, but it was just like...
Like watching a black and white movie.
Sort of, yeah. Maybe a tint of colour.
Tint of colour.
And it kind of, if I could equate it with eating or a taste, it mm-hmm. was, you know, it felt like it was bland. It wasn't flavourless.
No spice.
Yeah, there was no, nothing to particularly enjoy or nothing particularly unpleasant.
Yeah.
It was just like... And what I found was I was just spending time with these people and we were all reassuring each other about the fact that we were okay, mm-hmm. basically.
Yeah.
And that went on for a long time, longer than I kind of want to admit.
Okay, so how long did that go on?
Like 50 years.
50 years, yeah.
Yeah.
Where basically each of you were feeding each other's addiction to feel good about themselves.
Yeah.
And you all were in codependence with each other about that, and so you couldn't leave the group.
No.
Because leaving the group would mean that you no longer get to feel good about yourself.
So. We no longer get to feel like we are good-hearted people.
Yeah.
And we'd no longer get to feel like we're acceptable people.
Yeah.
I can see now that all of us had problems with that.
Yeah.
And we kind of still had these compulsions, I suppose you'd call it, to be serving others, to try and help us.
Driven to do it.
Yeah. Mm. And so sometimes we would go and meet people when they're passing and sort of be around around
that
time.
Did the same thing somebody did to you.
Yeah. Try and what we kind of told ourselves we were helping them and we were loving them. We were bringing them into a group that wasn't going to harm them. And, you know, and we tried to sort of go and do good deeds.
On earth primarily. Or in the spirit world?
In the spirit world.
Yeah.
We didn't really go back to earth.
So I think, you weren't earthbound as a group?
No, and I think that...
That's probably fortunate.
It's fortunate. And I probably attribute that to avoiding my fear. Mm-hmm. I really didn't want to have any kind of reminder of my passing or my childhood.
Right.
And I think that's why I remained as I did.
Yeah.
A lot of other groups similar to ours don't.
No, they get earthbound and then do, you know, act out their desires on the earth instead.
Yeah, and kind of inspire or compel other people to do so-called good deeds so that
until
they can feel like
a part of it. Until their
own
condition darkens to such an extent that they can't manage the energy of it anymore.
Yeah. Mm. So I'd say in those 50 years, things gradually got worse and worse.
Mm-hmm.
And initially we didn't notice and then we reassure each other when we did notice.
What did you first notice? What were you first noticing? Things like your own body's degrading?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But we didn't look as good.
Yeah.
It was getting kind of darker.
Wasn't as bright as if the first part was bright at all. So the colours started disappearing altogether.
Yeah. Yeah. Somehow things felt more restricted.
Didn't have as much power to...
Yes, less power, couldn't go as many places.
Yeah.
And it felt... We weren't very self-aware about what was happening, but it just felt... Everything kind of started to feel more limited.
Yeah.
And I suppose we were going places initially... And doing things initially just through our intention and stuff. And
which
then,
is really your addictions.
Yes.
Which were out of harmony with love, which was causing the darkening condition.
Mm. Yeah. And then as the conditions got darker, it sort of, we weren't really aware because everything was happening on intention, but we would intend to go somewhere and it would just be a bit
hard.
Distance that we could go or something or
we,
you know, and it sort of dawned on us gradually over time
that your power was degrading.
Yes. Then we started to find that we were running into people who wanted to do us harm, basically.
Right.
And it really started to trigger our fears
and scare you.
We got so frightened.
Yeah.
All of us, because a lot of us had...
Because now you were getting closer and closer in condition to the people who have actually harmed you.
Mm.
And now they can potentially harm you. And
Or people like them. Some of them weren't, you know, initially they weren't as bad as the people who did harm us. But all of us had been harmed and felt kind of bad about ourselves. And so
you
it didn't take
much
for people who start coming along and... At first, we kind of tried to block it out. We reassured each other, all of that. And eventually,
just tried to stay as a tight-knit group.
Yep.
Yeah.
We literally became more and more huddled together.
Yeah.
Trying to reassure each
other.
So
at this stage, none of you had actually lived in a house or any of these things.
No.
Yep.
And eventually, we ended up in a kind of a situation where We were literally huddled together, kind of whispering, trying to whisper reassurance to each other.
Because you were too afraid to speak out loud, just in case it attracted those.
Well, no, we were surrounded by then by people who were really threatening us with horrible things, saying horrible things to us. And when
you say that, perhaps if we were a little bit more specific, these, of course, would have been, many of them would have been sexual or violently horrible things.
Yeah, threatening us.
Yeah.
And also just telling us that we were...
no good.
Yeah, we were bad, we didn't have a good bone in our body, that we were...
shaming you.
Yes, basically worthless, useless, stupid, all those kind of things.
Yep.
And then there was the people with...
dark intentions.
Specific threats, like, I'm going to do this to you, I'm going to do that to you. And then, I mean, it's still, I still have feelings talking about it because it wasn't very nice. Eventually the group started to break up, and some of them actually were kind of pulled away under the influence of these people who wanted to harm us.
Which would have been very frightening.
It was so frightening for them, for us, and... just very, very traumatic, really. Very traumatic. And we felt powerless. Just like, what can we do? We're trying to do the right thing. We're not, you know, and we couldn't stop it happening, it felt like. And so gradually people are breaking away, and I'm getting more and more afraid. And for some reason, and I still don't really understand how or why this happened, it was getting very, very bad and darker and darker. It was just ended up two or three, there's three of us, two other people with me.
So how big was your group at the beginning?
Oh, like 40 people.
And now you were left with three.
Yep. And I knew that either it was, the next thing to happen was that one or both of them would be drawn away into the clutches of these abusive groups that were just circling us consistently. Yeah. Or it would be me that would be drawn away next. And I just could, I couldn't bear the thought of that. And, you know, I started to really sob.
Yeah.
And for some reason, I just, something in my heart called out to God.
So that's the first time you really called out to God?
Yeah.
After you passed 50 years earlier?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I didn't understand that I'd never really called out to God before.
Yeah.
A lot of times we'd say we were praying and things and doing things for God, and then...
which wasn't a personal feeling for God at all.
No, and this, and I didn't even realise that I was going to do it, and I did it.
Yeah.
And it was so incredible what happened next. It was literally like a, almost like a beam of light just came out of nowhere and into me.
And of course all the dark spirits fled.
Yes.
Yeah.
They left, and I found myself in a brighter place immediately. And
was that a bit confusing initially? Or just a relief?
I was just so overwhelmed emotionally, I suppose. I was just sobbing in fear and terror, and then sobbing about receiving a connection with God, and then sobbing about the overwhelming relief that I was in a different place. And then sobbing, praying for my friends who had, you know, weren't with me then, and I didn't know where they were.
Yeah.
And I've since come to find a lot of them and help them, which has been in a small way that I can, but it's been good.
Yeah, that's wonderful.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so I was sobbing. but that's probably the turning point for me that really changed everything.
That's the first time you let yourself cry.
Cry and really, I mean, I'd cried a lot on earth. And,
I mean, in the spirit world.
In the spirit world. Yeah. And I'd cried in the spirit world as well,
not a real feeling.
I'd not let go to crying in terror.
Yeah.
And I had not longed with my heart to God. Yeah. I hadn't reached. It's like a reaching for God. It felt like.
Yeah.
And an opening up.
Yeah.
that I had never experienced in my whole life on earth or in the spirit world. And that's what changed the course of my life.
Yeah. And how long ago did that happen?
Not long, just a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
And my life has changed a lot since then.
So where are you now?
Yeah, I'm similar to Glenn. I'm right
in the second sphere.
Yeah, my friends are telling me, you know, nearly ready to make the transition into the third, which Wonderful. Is so exciting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Very exciting. Yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah, to that, if you think about it now, what as you look back on that, you can see that there was a huge amount of resistance to fear, to the feeling of fear.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Definitely. And I can see that I lived in trying to avoid fear my whole life on earth.
Yeah.
And then as soon as I passed as well, I feel as I was passing, I was the closest to my fear that I had been since I was a little girl.
Yeah.
And I didn't surrender to that when I was on earth, and I didn't surrender in the immediacy of my passing. I can see now that there were spirits there.
Who were trying to help you
do that. Who were trying to help me do that, mm-hmm. and I just was still in this compulsion to avoid it, and I just went straight with the first group who was going to...
help you do that.
Yeah.
So the compulsion to avoid the fear, if you could change that, that would have had a large change to what happened at the time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The real thing that I think that would have changed the course of my life much sooner is if, while I was on earth, got really, I faced the issues that happened to me in my childhood.
Yeah.
If I faced that abuse head on.
Yes. Very few people do it though, don't they?
If almost
no one on earth has ever really done it.
Not properly.
There's a few that do it in their addictions, and there's quite a number who do it in what I would classify as a tantrum, but very few who do it sincerely.
From my experience now, I can see that it's important to experience the shame and terror of it.
Yeah.
And I can see that many people cry in anger about what they feel they've lost, or cry in just a feeling that they'll never be free of it.
Yeah. Hopelessness.
Or feel angry and feel okay to punish people because of it, or to justify their fear of it. But it's very few people who really just let go to the fear of it and the shame of it.
And just have a good cry about
that. The worthless feelings is the feelings underneath that I was trying so hard to... I'd identified so much that those events had defined my worth.
Mm.
But of course, all of that was very hidden under
under the facade that you'd created to manage it all.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. So, if you reflecting upon that, what would you like to say to the people in the groups that you've observed? Because you've gone around with Sonia and observed some of the people who are coming along to our groups.
I suppose I would like to say that firstly, to be aware of the compulsion to tell yourself you're spiritual when you're really hiding a feeling that you're not and that you never can be.
Yeah.
Because in my experience, the only way I have truly begun to experience the gifts of having a spiritual life was to first confront a lot of the terrible abuse that I felt deserving of, to face the truth that wasn't the case.
No.
But I can see that a lot of people who come to your groups don't want to even acknowledge that feeling inside of themselves, not really.
Yeah.
They use that
They talk about it.
They talk about it and they use it as an excuse to behave, either to behave very badly towards other people.
They do, yeah.
Or to, they just deny it completely and try to earn God's love and earn their worth.
Through action.
Through action, and they create false emotions to try and feel like...
that they're progressing on the path.
And that they don't feel the way that they do.
Yeah.
And
So
I suppose that's some of the things that I see that are problems for people.
Yeah.
And I suppose I see that some people say that they're like me when they're really more like Sarah. And then some of the people who are more like me sometimes say they're like Sarah.
Yep. So what can we best do to summarise that? Because that's an important fact, that there's a lot of people who think they're bad people but have been just abused and believe themselves to be bad. Yep. And then there's a lot of people who think they're being abused when actually they're not being abused and they're actually quite bad.
Yep.
Yeah.
Well, I think you summarised it well.
Yeah.
To receive
the one's not facing the truth, is it?
Yeah, to receive the truth from people who seem to know about God and love and truth.
Yeah.
To listen to what they have to say and not to be afraid to face anything about yourself.
Yeah.
Whether it's that you're like Sarah or you're like me, or that you've been like me and you've become like Sarah, or to just not be afraid to face whatever it is, because it's not permanent.
Yeah.
It's not
your real self.
It's not what God created.
Mm.
Even if, you know, and we've all tried to come and just share who we are without judgment, because God doesn't judge it.
No.
And I see a lot of people wasting time judging.
Yeah, both themselves and others.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah. Yeah, well, I think that's pretty good advice. Yeah. So basically, in summary, it's been 50 years or so of avoiding fear before you chose to actually feel it.
Mm-mm. And acting, not just avoiding fear, avoiding the feelings of shame.
Shame and low worth.
And creating a fantasy of being spiritual.
Yeah.
When I really didn't have any, I missed the mark of spirituality.
Yeah.
By a long way.
Yeah. And because you were just driven by fear, really.
Yes. Driven, my motivations to do good were not pure, they were selfish.
Yeah.
And my motivations to feel close to God even, or to know about God, were not pure. They were in order to avoid these feelings about myself. And so when those intentions aren't pure, I can't really serve others or get to know God.
No, they're good lessons. Yeah. And I suppose the important thing for many of them is that many of them that have come along to our events are in a lot of fear without them being aware of how much fear they're actually living in.
And that was so much for me.
Mm.
I didn't understand, like, in my life on earth, I just didn't associate myself with a frightened person.
Yeah.
I didn't. I did not want to acknowledge the first 10 years of my life, really.
Mm-hmm.
And I built a facade, I built a persona after that fact, all in an effort to suppress the fear and terror and shame and yucky feelings about myself that I had from those first 10 years. And so I denied any sense of my fear. And so I...
And your addiction surrounded feeding the denial of your fear.
And the worthless feelings.
Yeah.
And And so I wouldn't have said that I was a frightened person. And I agree that most people on earth don't acknowledge their fear. Yeah.
Mm. Mm.
Or they sort of wear it like a badge without really acknowledging it.
Yeah.
Use it to justify controlling other people.
Yeah, use it, as you said, to justify very poor behaviour towards others. Mm. Yeah. Yeah, so they are important lessons, I feel. One of the groups that we're going to have, obviously you would know, is about the facade and, you know, the addictions, the feeding. And you can see in your case how the behaviours you chose in your life on earth and also in the spirit world were all just pretty much addictions to feed the facade, which helped you avoid the fear that was under the facade.
Yeah.
So, in other words, helped you avoid the hurt self, the person that you really felt you were as a child.
Mm.
And
and
we see that pattern happening a lot with people that we spend time with.
And I suppose that I would want to say to people, like, don't fight the breaking down of your facade. Don't fight it so much, because it really is the best thing that can happen.
Because if you had submitted in the same way to your fear as you had of, even at the beginning of the period of time when things started to get darker and you started to become more afraid in the spirit world, then change could have occurred much sooner, couldn't it?
Yeah. It would actually have lessened my fear, but instead I lived in fear and dread and terror. The more and more it went on, and the more people we attracted and more of my friends who were drawn away, it prolonged my fear. But then once I really just surrendered to just sobbing out the terror of it, my heart opened up to God, and immediately the fearful situation I was in changed.
Yes, yeah. And you understand now, of course, why these people were drawn away in those circumstances.
Yes.
And maybe we need to clarify that a little for people who are listening.
Well, they submitted to their fear instead of surrendering to it.
Correct.
They did what their fear said they should do.
To pander to the people who were abusive.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's a bad pattern we see happening on earth too. Mm-hmm. People continuing to pander to the people who are more abusive, thinking that that will make the abuse go away, when actually what it does is heighten and allow you to be more abused.
Yeah.
So that's a pattern that's quite severe on the planet too. Mm. And also quite a lot happening with people we know as well. Yeah. Well, I feel they're very good lessons, Mandy, that if anybody listens to those, I think they'll benefit from that. So is there anything you'd like to say before you go?
No, I just hope that might help some people, and I'd be happy to come back and talk again, and if I can help in any way. I feel much more sincere in my desire to help these days.
And
I would love to do that with anyone with the issues of facade in particular. And the hurt.
Yeah, and my feelings are that some of the people who are listening to the recording itself can always ask for you to come and help them understand some things if that's the place they recognise themselves to be.
Yeah.
Because quite often it is helpful having someone who's been through the situation to help through the situation as well.
Yep.
Mm.
It's helped me a lot talking to others who've been through what I've been through.
Yeah. So now you're enjoying your second sphere existence. Have you met up with your family, some of your family in a better condition and friends in better condition?
Yeah, some of them I have, and that's been really good.
And what's happened with your children? Are they've all passed now?
And I've seen them, and that's really good. Mm-hmm. They've had their own issues to work through with me, and then also just from what life brought them and so on. And
And have you met your soulmate?
Not yet.
Not yet. Not much of an interest there yet.
Not yet.
No. Why is that?
I suppose there's still just issues for me to work through about desiring closeness.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I understand. I'm not trying to put you on the spot. I probably wanted to say it because there's many people that we know who are living alone and they have no desire to meet the other half of themselves. And they don't realise that it's because of similar emotions where they don't trust or they feel that they'll be controlled or they feel that they'll be harmed by the opposite gender in a lot of cases, most cases. And as a result, they don't have a very strong desire either to meet their soulmate either. Yeah.
Yeah. I certainly feel much softer to the concept than I ever have.
Yeah, yeah.
And I'm looking forward to that, but I just know that there's more lessons for me to learn.
Before that happens.
Before that happens.
Yeah.
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 I certainly enjoy friendships now with both genders.
Which is good.
Yeah.
That helps work through things too, doesn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. It does. We also see that happening a lot on Earth, don't we, where the genders are very separate from each other
generally.
Yes,
and don't even embrace friendship with each other.
No. No, there's either sexual interaction or none at all.
It's funny that there's often sex without any emotional connection, really.
Yeah, or any friendship.
Or any friendship. Yeah. And people who commence friendships with the opposite gender often end up just with the sex and no real friendship either.
Yeah. So there's a lot of changes that need to happen here, and hopefully we can help some of them to occur.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it's been lovely talking to you, and thanks again for relating your experience.
Thank you.
We know it's painful to go back over those kind of experiences, and but also we know it's good and cathartic sometimes, isn't it?
Yep. Mm. Yeah. And I wanted very much to give you a good account of what happened.
Yeah. Mm. And I think there's many people who we know who are, again, in a similar position of yourself where they have been harmed but have chosen to avoid their terror and their fear.
Mm.
Yeah.
And having the facade of spirituality can actually be more damaging than having a real reflection of how you really feel about life and God and yourself.
You know, my own mother here on Earth is in the same condition as what?
With quite a facade of spirituality.
Yeah. And a similar level of fear.
Yeah.
So I know that she passed in a similar condition.
Mm. Okay. Mm. Thank you.
Thank you for your time.